So, can you tell us about your new mixtape?
Yes. So it's obviously called The Mistress 2. It's a sequel to the first one that I did. I did the first mixtape a couple of years ago while I was writing my last album with Cash Money. So it was the album itself was more pop R&B, whereas this is a straight R&B album. So for me, you know, The Mistress came out of really frustration of not being able to channel everything I wanted to put into the real album. Ended up doing this sick album, which I gave away as a mixtape. The reason why I did this in the first place is because when I listen to hip hop and I think they're so brutally honest in their lyrics, brutally honest. They'll say that stuff. Why is it with singers, we sugarcoat everything and we say just things a little bit too sweet and it's not always as honest and hardcore as it is in hip hop. So I was like, how about if I wrote this whole thing with the mentality of a rapper? So he's just writing it as it is, 100% from the heart, telling the truth, but of course with sick, beautiful melodies to go with it, but telling a very raw, raw story.
Yeah, okay. So is this encouraging mistresses to come to your show and try and get with you?
Like, nah. It's nothing to do with that. Obviously, a funny title to have, considering the news is out that I'm married and I've got a kid. Yeah. So obviously, I think the deep thing is that when I did this, there's a song called She Has No Time on the first Mistress. When my producer heard that, my manager heard that, he pulled me aside and he was like, yo, real talk, if you're messing with your girl, like right now, if you're cheating on your wife, we need to know about this. Because if a news breaks out, we need to control this. I was like, dude, relax. It's a fictional story. But he was so pulled in by the lyrics because it was so deep and honest that he thought it was my true story. But, and I'm talking about sitting there that's so real, you know what I mean? The kind of stuff that guys talk about, but we just don't necessarily want to say it in front of people. But that's what I'm saying. I'm saying it in front of everyone.
This mixtape, you said, am I right in saying that this is more of the mixtape you wanted to make as opposed to some of the poppy stuff on your album?
Yeah, 100%.
So then what makes you make this a mixtape as opposed to just a brand new
album? Because I'm giving it for free. Okay. That's why. So originally, like when I did The Mistress 1, I couldn't put it out as an album because I was signed to Cash Money at the time. And, you know, of course, clearance issues and all that. And so I was like, but I want the world to hear this. So I'm going to put it out and I won't make any money off it. So I'll put it out, and that way, as long as I don't make money off it, it's legal. Because otherwise, you know, if I tried to make money off something that Cash Money owned, I could get sued. But because if you give it away for free, it's just something artistic that you're putting out there, you understand? And so now, because even though I have left Cash Money, The Mistress 2 I'm still going to give away for free because I want this entire series to be a gift to my fans. I want them to know that it's something that I love, and music that I love that I think I had kind of deprived them of for a little bit.
Under Cash Money then, do you think that you couldn't really express yourself in the way, in the Mistress kind of way?
Yeah, I think I got to a point where, you know, like I'm an R&B boy, so at heart, that's what moves me, that's what I love, that's what I like to sing, that's what I like to write. But when you have so much success in the pop world, bro, it's so hard to kind of reverse and go, hold on, but check this out too. Because people are like, what? No. Do you do this. Do this. That's what we know you for, right? Do this. And then you're kind of like, oh, well, that's one side of me, yeah. But it's like, not every, you know, we're not one-trick ponies, you know what I'm saying? Like, that fun, up-tempo side is a side of me. When we're going out, we want to put on a tune to get us hype. That's one side of me. But then what about all the other sides as an artist and as a singer and as a songwriter? Let me showcase that. But I couldn't get the chance to showcase that with Cash Money.
So was it more, it felt a little bit like it was trying to be a family, but was it more of a machine? And being in, if it was, is it more restrictive to what you want to say?
Cash Money is a family. I'm not going to lie. Like they do, when I say it's a family, I mean that they wouldn't just pick up anyone just because they thought they're hot. They really do literally treat you like fam, right? They never were, you know, like they're not corporate. You know what I'm saying? They're not that, they haven't got that corporate vibe. So I could turn around to Baby and I could be like, to Birdman, I could be like, yo, bro, I'm sorry, man, I ain't feeling this album, bro. I know that we had a deadline for this, but I'm not feeling it anymore. I need more time, I need an extension, or I need to scrap this. And he'd be like, yo, do you. If that's what you want to do, if you're not happy with it, do you. But then the thing is, when it came to the singles, it's just, it's harder for me to try to negotiate him to put a money towards an R&B joint that radio might not be playing as much as they would be playing an up-tempo pop record. And that is when you understand that it's just a business.
With Tiger's current situation, him not being happy with the label, is that similar to your sort of feelings?
I talked to Tiger the other day, and you know, I know that it's a frustration that we're feeling. You know what I mean? It's just a frustration. I think I can't fully speak on Tiger's behalf, but I know that for him, he had deadline issues. Like his album was finished and ready to come out, but it kept getting pushed back. And that's frustrating for us as artists as well, because we know it's done. But for reasons beyond our control, you know what I'm saying? That's why release dates keep getting pushed back. Because you got to understand, labels have rosters. Then they have like all of this other stuff, like deals with advertisers and this, that, and the other. So, let's push his back until we can tag him on with so-and-so's album and we'll get a good deal at Best Buy or at whatever. You understand? And so all of a sudden you're like, well, I just went and told all my fans that my album's coming out in a week and now it's not coming out for another 3 months. It makes us look crazy. So I think that's why even Tiger's mentality of owning his own thing is the same as mine. I'd be like, I would rather control my own destiny and control my own career.
Okay, so even though you're not on the label anymore, is the relationship still good? Are you open for more collaborations with Cash Money?
I mean, it's so fresh right now, but yeah, we didn't leave on bad terms. You know, we left on good terms, and like I said, I told him that I appreciate everything that they'd done for me and that we made history together. And we really did have an amazing relationship, you know, especially me and Birdman were like really close, you know what I'm saying, while we were there, because I think he really appreciated the fact that me being from outside of America, he got to know so much about the rest of the world through my journey and my travels and my music, you know what I mean? And likewise, I got to know about his world. What the hell did I know about a hip-hop world from New Orleans, you know what I mean? Nothing, complete fish out of water. But I learned about their lifestyle and their world. So there was a lot of great stuff that came out of being signed at the label.
With that, seeing like both sides of the machine in and out of like a major label, does that make you still want to sign with a major label or just start an independent?
I would only sign with a major label now if they understood 100% my vision. That's it. And I'm not being arrogant or anything, but I feel like I've earned that. You know what I mean? I've been around for 12 years now. I've had broken a lot of records, sold a lot of records. So for me, I feel like I have the right to be able to keep my artistic integrity intact. If, you know, I don't need your help if you're going to put me into a lane that I'm not going to be happy in again, because clearly I have a history of walking out of labels if I'm not happy, you know what I mean? So, but if they get my vision, bro, then yes, of course, I would love to team up with people who are also like-minded and brilliant in that frame of mind. So, you know, in a situation like that, yeah, then I would probably do that.
Okay, so you've sold records pretty much all over the planet, in Japan and like loads of parts of Asia. And even though you come from an R&B background, does that, again, factor into how you make music?
I'm not really influenced too much by different countries or my travels or anything like that. I think I just know my music so well. I know my identity so well. What I do learn from selling records and performing around the world is it's interesting what songs gravitate to what people in what countries. For example, in Asia and Southeast Asia and Korea and all those places, they're deep on ballads. They love ballads. They just love to sit there and hear ballads. Then there's other places like South America or, you know, I don't know, Dubai or Vegas, where all they want to do is party. So there they want to hear the up-tempo stuff. When you try to break down into a little acoustic guitar thing, they're going to be like, what? No, please. Why? But they're still your fans, but they came for a different reason. So you understand what different places want out of you.
So every album has like a ballad and then something up-tempo for different
reasons. That's usually, you know, how I do it. But like this, The Mistress, for me, is all one vibe. Like if you listen to, for example, you know, a Drake record, if you listen to Nothing Was the Same, it has a feeling throughout the whole thing. Certain ones bump a little louder and you could like, you know, bop your head to it more so than a different one. But nothing's like still going to be necessarily an up-tempo, you know what I mean? They all has a vibe. It's a mood. And that's the same thing with me. That's why I love Drake as an artist, because I think he thinks about his work a lot and he creates moods and he sticks with his mood. And this is a mood.
Okay. So you said yourself you've been in the game over 12 years. Mm-hmm. During that time, you've collaborated with like UK underground legends like Skepta and mm-hmm. Chipmunk. How have you viewed their year, and do you have plans to work with them again?
I would love to reconnect with them boys. I haven't had a chance to reconnect since here, but for sure, 100%. And also, like, you know, for me, it's just amazing to see that scene flourish like that and grow the way it had. When I started, man, even way before I started doing music, I used to spit. I used to rap from the age of 13 up until 19. That's all I did. And then I won loads of talent competitions here in England. I won the Choice FM, the Night Flight, Commander B, the talent show as a rapper. You know what I mean? And the thing is, people don't know that, but I've been in the game for such a long time. The only reason why I stopped the rapping and carried on with the singing was because I remember DJ 279 at the time from Choice said to me, he was like, yo, listen, he's like, you got skills, no doubt, but the UK rap scene is difficult, bro. You know what I mean? And he's like, it's really, really hard. And at those times, bro, we had people like, it was like Funky DL and Black Twang who were around, and they were still underground, but they never got the shine that nowadays these UK rappers have. They never got into the charts like our boys do now. So it's just so nice to see how the scenes come along.
So being from both sides, America and the UK, what do you think it would take for a UK rapper to break in America?
It's very hard, man. It's very hard. I mean, Tiny had a little success over there. I know Tinchy was trying, but the difficulty they have, and I'm just going to be straight up, they don't understand us when we speak like that. They don't get it. The accent. It has everything to do with the accent. So when we're speaking like the way that we're speaking or spitting in the way that we're spitting, they don't hear what we're saying. They have difficulty understanding me when I'm just speaking English, like this. Sometimes they're like, yo, man, slow down, man. I'm like, okay, so, and then it's not because they're not tuned to listening to that. Yo, but it's the same thing. When Young Thugger and all those guys speak, I don't know what they're saying. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, no, actually, I don't know what you just said. You know what I'm saying? But that's how they speak. So that's has a lot to do with that, man. It just doesn't connect. Because hip-hop is about connecting, right? It's about connecting with someone and your fan, and so they feel like they're part of your journey, like part of your story that you're telling them. If you can't understand what they're saying, how can you feel connected?
Well, Skepta said something along the lines of, basically, the UK accent could just be viewed as another state. You know how southern states versus like New York.
He has a point.
Yeah.
He has a point, you know what I mean? But, like, you know, for example, when it comes to Skep, when I think of Skep, like, I've always loved Skep's delivery and his tone and his voice. And he is very, like, you can hear what he's saying. He enunciates everything well. And it's like, you know, I personally think Skep would have a great chance in America. I've actually played some of Skepta's music to Birdman. Yeah, and he really, you know, he thought it was dope. He thought it was sick. And I wanted to bring Skep through. But at the time, it was just too difficult. I couldn't facilitate it. It was all getting crazy. Drake's whole thing was kicking off a lot. And it was just getting really, really heavy in there. But I wanted to bring Skep through.
So did he understand what Skep was saying?
He just thought it was sick. I don't know if Birdman understood necessarily, but I played it to some of the other guys. I played it to Mac Main and those guys, and they were like, yo, he's got skills. I think they could clearly tell he's got skills.
Okay, so do we have another album on the horizon?
For sure, I'm going to get back. As soon as I get back to the States, I'm going to start on the next one, you know what I mean? And the album will be, like, this time it will be an album, but it will be this vibe, you know what I mean? It will be this feeling, this R&B. This is what I do, you know what I mean? So now at least I get the chance to do that now.
Okay, and are you going to be in the UK more?
For sure, I'm going to be here more, man, for sure. Like I said, it was difficult for me. My hands were tied. Being in America to make journeys back here and promote was difficult. Everything was popping off over there so hard that for me to disappear for a couple months, you know, it would almost be impossible over there where they're like, but you have Jay Leno performance and blah, and the David Letterman appearance here and there. And it was like, okay, and then you get into this thing where you're like, well, I don't want my UK fans to feel disconnected because I don't want them to feel like, man, just went over there and forgot about us. So now, again, now that I'm independent, I can do that. I can make my own schedule. I can do everything I want.